better and better, and every year we keep thinking, how can we outdo it next year?
You know him, you love him, you've probably talked his ear off. Give a round for a fantastic show to Mr. Teddy Rogers.
How about that Davy Brooks? I gotta tell ya, does he add class to a show?
I watched the harbor line.
Smiling, I owe it all to you.
Susie told me I had to mention you again, Smiley, just to make sure. That's actually what she calls Greg Raps. And I definitely don't want to be remiss, because without John Allen, we would not have a Bar Harbor, we would not have Docks at Work, we would not have so many things, we wouldn't have had a band, the whole bit. So from all of us, John, thank you for hosting a great, great operation.
Bar Harbor on Gull Lake, and sitting with me right now, Mr. John Allen, the owner, the manager, the man is what it comes down to when it comes to Bar Harbor. John, welcome.
Thank you.
Not sure if that's the custom, me welcoming you to your place, it's your show, but we'll break a little tradition here for a while. Now, you've been into the Woodville situation for quite a while. Not only do you have a fantastic place here, but from years, not every year, but more often than not, you've had a boat in the show. Do you have anything this year?
Well, we do. We have five different boats here, ranging from the newest member of our collection, Windcrest, which is a 1931 Purdy Racer, to the Johnny Barnes, which is a 1931 26 Triple Cockpit by Earl C. Barnes, and then Rebecca Page, a 30-foot Packer, and a couple other ones as well.
Now, those of you that are sitting at this show and you're having a great time, you're thinking, wow, you know, just hang out on the lawn, have something to drink, have something to eat. Essentially, John is putting this on at his house in a way. You don't live here, I know, but this is almost like putting on a party, bringing all of your closest thousands of friends. Let's bring your boats, bring some food, let's get together and have a little fun. where'd you get the idea for a party, a grand old get-together like this?
Well, I don't know the idea was mine, but it was hatched with Ted Rogers and Jason Rash and Lee Anderson and a group of other collectors in the area to have a show at Bar Harbor 8 years ago. And this is kind of the evolving nature of the show. It went from a very modest beginning, like most things do, to becoming what many regard as the finest antique boat show in the country.
That starts out with the people who made this show work like it really has. I mean, without the combination of everybody putting their best into it, I'll tell you what, we would have had a real, real tough time. But to begin with, of course, Melissa Johnson and Jason Rash. Melissa spent all day organizing, all night complaining, directing us again, so here we are today, thanks to Melissa. Jason Rash and Jeremy Rash, the crews on the dock, handled all of the situations that arose, did a great job. And then, of course, there's our gracious hosts. Those guys are the guys that are responsible for the meals that we had, for the service that we had, and for all of the things that went on inside. And also, I do want to thank you skippers again. I mean, without you guys, obviously, we wouldn't have this variety. I don't know how many times I was told by guys that have been to shows all around the United States, internationally, the whole bit, about the variety of boats and the venue that we have for a boat show. You can put this down as one of the best, because if nothing else, I believe it.
Coming off of a massive success that was the 2015 International Show, that was last year in September, that took some time to get it to come here. Now that you've had almost a year to reflect on something like that, the things that you learned, things have changed here every year. You got gas docks this year. How does an event bringing in some of the best boats, not just in Minnesota or the region, but the world, how does that get you feeling that they all came to your place?
Well, it was a wonderful opportunity for us to put on a pedestal Minnesota's resort culture, Minnesota's cabin culture, and to show the North American boat collectors the preeminent position we enjoy as an antique boat location as well. And I think it is something that spoke very highly of the Brainerd Lakes area. We do have hospitality in our DNA, and the people who left here knew that they had a good time when they left, and they knew that they want to come back to Minnesota for another international boat show in the very near future.
So now, the history of this place. Bar Harbor has been around for a while. I know the building isn't the original building. This place, though, goes down in the lore of a lot of places that have been here for a long, long time. It goes way back. You talk about places like Granby. You talk about places like Manhattan Beach. They've got a history that goes back to Prohibition and even before that. Can you tell us a little bit about the history of Bar Harbor even before your time here?
Well, I think most people understand and know that Bar Harbor was founded in 1938 by Irv Anderson as a dance hall, eating establishment, and they had a few other enterprises on the premises, including gambling and other situations, but that stayed there until 1968 when it burned down. A year or two later, they built a building that stayed there until 2004, and of course, this particular facility was completed in 2004, renovated in 2011, and we've owned it for the last 5 years. A terrific history. I like to say, I think half of Minnesota in the 1940s and 1950s met their wives at Bar Harbor.
Now, I have to bring it up because some of the buildings that have been around here, those establishments, the history, some of it, let me put it this way. Since you walk the halls here as the proprietor, the owner, do you think any people from the past still wander around here, if you know what I mean?
I don't know if I can comment on that.
That I cannot do.
I know a lot of people from the past come here. They come to the Bar Harbor because for them it represents a special place or time. They spend a little time in the realm of reminiscing, whether it was with their great-great-grandparents or their grandparents or their mom and dad. And that's all we want to continue to seek to do, make memories for the future and give people the opportunity to come back to what is a terrific, terrific location here on Gull Lake and Lake Shore, Minnesota, and contiguous to the Twin Cities of Nisswa and Lake Shore.
Let me ask you another question. Since you are a part of a long legacy here, not just in boats, but with Bar Harbor, you know, people have spent their lives coming up here in their youth, having a great time, liking to continue it as far into their lifespan as they can. And now you come in and you continue to give them not just the opportunity, but a really classy, really quality experience that they can continue like when they were younger and to continue on with their kids going forward. What does it mean to you to be a part of a legacy, not just when it comes to wood boats, but at a really classy place, a really classy gin joint like Bar Harbor? What does that mean to you?
Well, I think we take and derive great pleasure from making memories with people, and I really think that our staff here, starting with P.J. Severson, who is our executive general manager, and Corey Palmer and Ross Johnson, do a wonderful job with our overall staff, delivering a really exceptional experience, and for us, that's what we want to do. We want to do what we do well every day and get better at it every day, and having this many people come out today and enjoy the show gives our staff and our management, and I think all the people who are involved in the show, a great deal.
You know, one thing I can say is that every year, Bar Harbor, not just for the show, but as a place on any other day of the week, gets better every year. The renovation, you said, was completed in 2011, but in a lot of ways, it's not quite done. The building might be done, but there's always a change. You got a gas dock this year that hasn't been here before. You are a part of the boating culture. You know what you're looking for when you go to a different place. You try to put as much of that into what you offer out, giving, I would say, probably one of the more quality examples of a place, if not the place, to want to go to. And that adds to that legacy in a major, major way. So just from that point of view, that's pretty darn awesome.
Well, thank you. And we are pleased. We are going to open the gas docks. Actually, they're functional right now. So for the first time in the history of Bar Harbor, we have gas docks. And we are very excited to have all you come by here and fill your boats up with gas and make this your destination, not only in the summer months, come back and visit us when we have lots of capacity in the winter months as well.
We're talking La Nina, that means snowy, that means cold, that means when your pipes are frozen at your place and you're not going to be able to cook in Christmas vacation or Thanksgiving, Bar Harbor is the place to go. John Allen, you do an amazing job here. Thank you for having us over. Thanks for the boats. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
This is John Allen, Bar Harbor, the place, they're one and the same.
My head keeps spinning. I go to sleep and keep grinning. If this is just the beginning, my life is gonna be beautiful. I've sunshine enough to spread. It's just like the fella said. Tell me quick, ain't love a kick in the head. Said, ain't that a kick in the head? Like a sailor said, quote, ain't that a hole in a boat? Grinning, if this is just the beginning. My life is gonna be beautiful. She's telling me we'll be wed
you own a boat rental business? Boats and Beyond. My dad's just taught me all of the stuff I know about knots and all that stuff, so.
Now here's the funny thing. This is a story that I've heard from a couple of different people that I'll share that I've already heard about you. Some people, they think they know better. They're like, oh, you know, I got this. Here, I'll help you talk. No, I got this. And I've seen more than a few times, they learn really quick. No, actually, I don't. This 14-year-old girl, she knows more about this boat and how to keep it safe and how to tie it up than I do. How does that make you feel, 14 years old, and you can outboat some of the people that have been boating since the 60s?
It feels pretty good because, I don't know, I'll just be doing this my whole life and be on boats my whole life, hopefully, so it'll be a good skill to have, I guess.
So now let's just talk boats, all right? Something got you into loving boats in the first place, right? What is your first that you can remember memory of, I love these boats? What's the first thing that you can remember?
Well, on our boat when we lived in California, I just have seen like videos and stuff of me sleeping on the boat and stuff as a baby. So I've just been on boats my whole life. And
what is it now that you're a little older and you can appreciate some more involved parts of a boat? What is it about a boat that just pulls you in?
Probably the sound of them and like the smell. I don't know, I like the smell too, so.
Is it just the exhaust or the smell of the boat itself?
Pretty much like the exhaust and the gas and stuff. I don't know, I just like that smell.
I know exactly what you mean. I used to work for a bunch of summers, if you've ever gone to Ye Olde Wharf up on the Whitefish Chain. I worked there on the docks, because you are basically what I was when I was 14 and younger, and I thought I could might as well do a job with it. So you're doing it here, I did it at Ye Olde Wharf. They called me the Dock Lord forever. That name still sticks with me. So when you get into boats, and you show up like you know what you're talking about, walk me through. You get some old guy, I've been driving this boat since Eisenhower was in office. What is their response when they see you step in and then they become aware, whoa, she really knows her stuff?
They seem pretty surprised, I guess, because a lot of people think that they don't know that I can do stuff. And so they seem pretty surprised when I actually like tie them up good and it's not like floating away from the dock. So, yeah.
I wish I had a length of rope with a post or something. Because give me a sheep shank right now, go. I learned sheep shanks and how to tie things up and cleat off and you name it, pole and knot. What was the first knot that you knew how to do?
Probably half hitch, because we have cleats at our marina and stuff and that works for that and then posts too.
Were you the type that would just sit with a shoelace or something at a school desk and just tie knots when you weren't paying attention in class?
Yeah, pretty much.
So I'll tell you one thing. What is your favorite? I asked you before, and you were thinking about it. What is your favorite kind of boat? And I don't necessarily mean wood or fiberglass or aluminum. What's your favorite kind of boat? Is it a ski boat? Is it an inboard? Is it, what is it, the kind of boat that if you were going to grab, I want that one, what would you grab?
Probably an inboard. I don't know, those ones just have better sound, I think, than outboards, so. And that's one of the main things I like about boats.
Do you like more of the kind of inboard and wakeboards that they got now that don't kind of have that, it almost sounds like a drum gallery, or do you like the old resorters, the old wood boats that almost sing to you?
Yeah, I like the old ones better because I just like the sound and it's more relaxing, so. I mean, I like the wakeboard boats and stuff too, but if you're just going on a cruise or something, it's better to be on an old one.
You know, at my house, I've got a little 1947 Chris Craft. I keep it under one of those awnings. Even now, and I'm almost 40, I'll go down. I don't have any intention of taking it out. Like tonight, it might be a rainy night, but I want to be in the boat. I might go down there, start it up, and just let it sit in the water and for an hour. I might. It's possible. That's going to be you.
Yeah, it probably will be me.
So now you're part of this new generation that's going to be taking boating wood boats and all boats into the future from here. Who got you started? Everyone's got that person or a couple people that really got them involved at first. Who do you credit with getting you into boats?
Definitely my dad. he just has always been on boats with me, and since recently I've got to drive by myself, but whenever I'm on a boat, it's always with my dad or by myself. Just the other day, it was really, really windy out, and I was in the little Boston Whaler, and it was super wavy, and my dad's just like telling me what to do with the waves and stuff, and it actually helped a lot. So
you watch. Right about now, this is the ratio. Before long, it's going to be like this. And you, Dad, I got this. Just sit in the back and be quiet. If you can't be quiet, I'm going to put you back at the dock. Dad, that day is coming. It's already coming. This is the future of boating, whether it's a fiberglass boat or an aluminum boat or a wood boat. So when you got little kids here, you got a great opportunity to get them, just like Cassidy. They don't have to become the dock person, but get them into the culture, because this is the way of things. Cassidy, it's a pleasure to meet myself in the past.
Thank you. Love to be here and come back next year.
She's going to be here today, so when she tells you to follow the rules of the dock, I'm not just kidding. She'll put you in an arm bar, and I guarantee you she knows more than you do. Cassie, thanks for coming. Enjoy yourself today. Cassie, the head dock gal down on the docks today, make sure you give her some congratulations and encouragement, and remember to listen to what she says, for she is wise. Probably about 10 people at this show today that you can accurately describe as Mr. Woodboat. They know their stuff. They've been involved in woodboats from longer than others. But one of my guests that's joining me today is most definitely worthy of the title, Mr. Woodboat. I'd like you to say hello to Mr. Carl Mammel. Carl, hello.
Good morning.
Now, Carl, you've got a history in wood boats that you and I were just talking about a little while ago, and you and I, we've crossed paths a bunch of times at the Whitefish Chain Boat Show. Tell me a little bit more about one of my favorite questions to ask. How did you get involved in wood boats to begin with?
Well, I've had a place in Alexandria, Minnesota for many years, and I had a fiberglass boat, and I had a daughter who said that she wanted to have her own boat. So I started to look around, and I saw fiberglass boats, and I also saw some wood boats, and I knew her interest was in historical things, and I thought, this would be great. Well, you should get a historical boat and probably a wood boat. So as I looked at wood boats, I realized that the values were reasonable, and I encouraged her to get a boat.
So you've gotten such a fever for this boat, and you decided, rather than to go with a fiberglass boat, which was popular at the time, to go classic. And I gotta say, that was a very good, smart move, to the point now that you've gotten even more involved, particularly if you're on the I-94 corridor going through Alexandria. You're gonna find the Maritime Museum there, a lot of history. Tell me a little bit about the Maritime Museum in Alexandria.
Well, first of all, let me tell you how it happened. After I ended up with a wood boat, I met a friend of mine named Tom Akinson. And between the two of us, we thought, gee, we ought to have a museum here about wood boats and about the history of the Alexandria Resort area. And so we started that up, that idea. And it took us about 10 or 15 years to finally get it put together. But this year, we celebrated the 10th anniversary of the Minnesota Lakes Maritime Museum, now known as the Legacy of Lakes Museum. And we have probably 15 or 20,000 square feet of space where we have not only wood boats, but also some historic fiberglass boats, and a lot about the history of the resort community around Alexandria.
It does say something. I remember when the late 80s, these wood boat shows kind of got started, whether it's Minnetonka, whether it's Whitefish, and wood boats were kind of the classics. fiberglass boats, you know, they've been around for a while, but we're getting to that point now here in 2016 where fiberglass boats, some of the old Larsons, some of the old Chryslers, are becoming classics in their own right, even some old aluminum-type boats. When you're talking about a classic boat, and I'm talking about just you yourself, what is it in a classic boat? Wood, glass, metal, whatever. What is it that gets your heart palpitating and gets you excited for these classic restored boats?
Well, it's the rarity of the boat and the style of the boat. And I learned something early on in my collection fever, and that is that I needed to have boats that were rare because that's where the value would be. And certainly this boat show here is a good example of that. There are many, many rare boats. I wouldn't have been able to do this without the help of Tom Jewell. At that time it was called the Alexandria Boat Works, and now it's the Jewell Boat Works. But Tom has restored all of my boats and is a master craftsman. And every boat that I've owned has either been restored or worked on by Tom Jewell. And he's here with his son right now, and I think has a boat here that he's showing. But certainly it wouldn't have been possible for me to do this without his help.
You know, it's very hard to talk about classic boats without a couple of names popping up, and Jewell most definitely the top of the list. They are the crown jewel as far as wood boats, restoring, preserving, and showing off at places like the Minnesota Lakes Maritime Museum. On top of that, we've also got, there's one boat that's here today that's actually from the Alexandria Museum, and it's one that people like to talk about a lot. And in fact, it's one boat that you can get a ride on today. It's putt-putting around right now because it's not currently at the dock, so it's somewhere out in the bay. Tell me a little bit about...
Well, at some point I decided I wanted to have a launch. I already had one launch, which is an Elko launch. It was not very large, and I thought it'd be terrific to have a larger launch, and it was something the museum could own and use. And so I went back to New York State and worked with a man back there to help find what is now a 26-foot 1907 launch, a Fay and Bowen launch, and it was a restoration by a man back in that part of the country. And that boat is used for lots of festivities at the museum. It's displayed in the museum from time to time, and we take it to the boat shows and people can enjoy a ride in it. It has a 2-cylinder, 4-cycle engine, approximately 10 horsepower, that operates the boat. And it's being driven by a good friend of the museum, Darren Erlinson, who takes care of the boat and provides the rides.
One interesting thing about that boat, to add to it, a lot of people like talking about the sound of the boat. The Stella is not that kind of sound. It's more like putt, putt. It's a very, it's, and how old is this boat? It's over 100 years old.
Well, it's 1907, yeah. In reality, it's only about 8 or 9 years old because it was totally restored, and every piece of wood in it is new.
So whether you're talking about Stella, you're talking about fiberglass, you're talking about boats that are 20 years old or 100 some years old, it's just fun taking a step back in yesteryear. You can do that at the Alexandria Maritime Museum. They're right on the Highway 94. You don't want to miss out. And there's great curators there that they know the history, and they've got the fever. They got the wood fever, Carl Mammel. It's worth making a special drive out to Alexandria again. I-94, just keep on going. It'll bring you right to Alexandria. They're right in the middle of downtown. Carl Mammel, are you going to be on the docks today or sitting somewhere to be talked to?
I'll be around. Thank you.
You want to talk history? You want to talk about how these boats are special? Carl Mammel, thank you very much, Carl. Enjoy yourself today. Get a chance to talk to Carl Mammel. I promise you're not going to regret it. So let's put a little knowledge down on the average layman people, and even people that know wood boats that don't know the Gold Cup. So you were talking about they have the G on the boat. There's a G and a number. What exactly does that mean if you have a G and the number? What does the G mean? What does the number mean?
Well, Gold Cup racing was just one category of racing. They had the national sweepstakes, had the presidential classes and so forth. One class had a T, one had a G. The G stood for Gold Cup, and if you were registered to race Gold Cup, they assigned you a number, and you kept that number unless you had the privilege of changing your number to G1 if you happened to win in any year, but then you had to give that up if you lost the following year. So anytime you see a G boat, you know it's really something special. But there are, I have to tell you, there's been a lot of replicas made of these various boats as well. So you're not sure if you're looking at the real thing or not. But no matter what, they're all beautiful. They started out very small engines back in the teens, and they gradually got bigger and bigger. And then they went to a standardized engine and a standardized boat that was 26 feet long. Then in 1929, they decided that they would change that, and they allowed the engines to go from 625 cubic inches to 731 cubic inches and have a step in the bottom. The step created lift, because the air could get under the boat and lift the boat out, and naturally they went faster. And then 1938, they allowed sponsons. And when you see My Darling out there, you'll see that it's on sponsons. So again, the boats went even faster because they got up on the sponson and tunnel air would rush underneath and make the boat lighter. So there's been a real big transition. The last flat bottom boat, like bootlegger, to win was in 1929. A boat called Imp, and I have that boat, and it's been to this show before.
Not only does he have the boats, he knows these boats. He knows the history. He knows what's in them. Let's switch gears a little bit to the gearheads. These boats have fired up a couple of times throughout the day. You'll know it because you'll feel it in your dental work, especially some of those racing boats. World War I fighter planes, is that what's in there?
Yes, exactly. A lot of the big engines were Liberty V-12s that were invented during World War I. And they were 1,200 cubic inches and 400 horsepower. Some of them were supercharged to 500-600 horsepower. And I don't know that there are any Liberties here today, but I have a number of boats with Liberties in them. The other engine was the Spano Suiza. That was a engine developed by both the Spanish and the French, and also fought in the First World War. Now I'm talking biplanes. These engines were made to compete in the various biplanes, and there were others as well. And remember, that boating didn't start out with a so-called marine engine. They were either motor car engines or airplane engines that were marinized, converted to use, and that's how they started out.
In the good old summertime, in the good old summertime.
The engine in bootlegger, that's a Hispano Suizo. We call it a Hisso. It's an E4 and it's 731 cubic inches, and that was the limit in the years that it raced for that particular boat.
So when you get a boat like this cranked up, and I understand sometimes firing them up at the dock is difficult because a lot of these boats are in gear all the time, what kind of top speed in today, 2016, when they're an older boat that's just being maintained, do you fully open them up and let them rip and pick bugs off your teeth after the skim in the lake, or do you only let them go so much?
Well, I don't do that because I don't want anything to happen to these engines, and there, some of them are irreplaceable, and parts are impossible to find. So if you see me out on the water with a race boat, it's probably going about 32 miles an hour, and I just enjoy it for what it is. Not interested in losing the engine. I lost an engine a few years ago, and believe me, it was a Peerless. It was the only six-cylinder Peerless that I know of still in existence, and I still don't have the engine back. So they had to redo the block and make new cylinders and everything else. But we're not going to do that again. No fast boats.
So that might be touching on my next point here. Anyone that does wood boats, whether it's a racing boat or whether it's just a barrel back or whatever it would be, These boats, let's face it, anyone that has one is going to know they break your heart. As much as you love them, you have to love them, because when they disappoint you, you want to take a hatchet to it. So I got to ask, have you had those moments where you're, I'm done with these wood boats, I'm going to get a bonfire going? What has broken your heart with these boats? I got to know.
Well, no, I don't. I think I'm beyond that. But I've had disappointments. I have boats that have been in restoration now. One boat for 3 years, and like the Peerless Engine, that's been a 3-year ordeal. And I just hope I outlive these things and get them back in time for me to see them in operation again. Restoration is a big part. There aren't any boats out here that are 80, 90 years old that haven't had a bottom replaced or sides or sometimes the decks, so forth. The wood just doesn't last that long. So we're always restoring, we're refinishing, we're doing this and that. And I make a list. Every time I go out in a boat, I take a little tablet and a pen and I start making a list of this doesn't work and that doesn't work, and that's never gonna end.
So let me ask you another thing. When you have an armada like you do, and it's a gorgeous fleet, what is it about those boats that you enjoy the most? Do you like to actually get behind the wheel and drive them? Do you like to sit in the back with a cocktail and the conversation? Do you just like to sit in the really cool boathouse and just get an easy chair and look and smell? And all? What is it that you really enjoy the most about these boats?
Yes. I do all three of those with equal relish. And I often go over to the boathouse and I'll just sit in the chair and just look around and just marvel and pinch myself, say, boy, I'm sure one lucky guy to be able to have all of these beautiful machines.
Now, we talked about, and that's exactly right. The good applause is right. You got to appreciate these boats. You have to have the bug. People that come to a show like this, I would love a wood boat. But if you don't have the bug, you're almost fighting an uphill battle. It's a mental illness that we all share. I know exactly what you've got. I'll ask you one more request, perhaps. When we're done with the interview, would you have any qualms about firing up one of those bad boys for the gearheads?
No. If I can see my fire-up guy down there, he's got on a red hat. No, he'll do that. We'll start my darling with the big Allison engine in it. That's the loudest. And he'll be happy to do that. We noticed we had the steam engine out there just a while ago, and of course it doesn't make any noise at all. So unless they blow the whistle. Yeah, sure, we'll do that. Be happy to.
Cool, so there you got it. If you'd like to hear these boats snort, this is going to be a little more than just that. So this is going to blow you out of the water. He's a class act guy. He's got an amazing armada. You want to sit this guy down, buy him a beer, and have a chat with him. Lee Anderson, always a pleasure. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Lee Anderson, you know his stuff. They got their whistle going for you right now. They heard you. They got the whistle blowing. They're going to fire up that boat here just a little bit.
Mr. Anderson.
Off then stepped a gambling man from Louisville who tried to get a bet against the whippoorwill. Billy flashed the roll that surely was a bear. The boiler, it exploded, blew them up in the air. The gambler said to Billy as they left the wreck, I don't know where we're going, but we're neck and neck. Says Bill to the gambler, tell you what I'll do. I'll bet another thousand I'll go higher than you. Oh, Steamboat Bill, he tore up the Mississippi. Steamboat Bill, the tide it made him swear. Oh, Steamboat Bill, he tore up the Mississippi. The explosion of the boiler got him up in the air. Steamboat Bill, missing on the Mississippi. He's a pilot on a ferry in that promised land.
You mentioned it here real quick. You've had some adjustments in the last year at the museum, now the Legacy of the Lakes Museum. Let's talk a little bit about what's been changing down there.
Well, we were previously called the Minnesota Lakes Maritime Museum, and the maritime word kept throwing a lot of visitors off. So we took a look at what we're displaying for folks, how we want to honor our guests when they come in, what kind of touch points we can offer them. So we came up with, after a long process, came up with Legacy of the Lake. So that touches everybody. We all have lake memories. We all enjoy the Minnesota Lakes culture. We all enjoy our 10,000 treasures that we have. And we all come at it from different directions. So it might be a family campfire. It might be staying in a little cabin. It might be fishing with a five-horse Johnson. It might be a beautiful mahogany boat or a fiberglass boat. So that's what we're trying to cover, all the different touch points that people have that relate to lakes. Boats being the main thrust, but there's a lot of other things that we're touching.
Speaking of some of those other things, clearly we're talking a lot of boats today at the boat show. But like you touched on, the Legacy of the Lakes as a museum and also as just pop culture and lakes culture goes, is a lot more than just the boats. Landmarks along the shore, boathouses, and a lot of those old ones have been disappearing, but a lot of them have been making a bit of a comeback, whether they've been being restored or you're talking about an old grand resort that is still a resort or maybe now being sold off into individual cabins, lakeside hotels. How does the Legacy of the Lakes Museum touch base with some of those other structures, the kind that don't always float?
Well, we talk about the history of living on the lakes and how people came to enjoy the lakes. It might have been the grand hotels in the late 1800s, early 1900s. It might have just been a very rustic family cabin quite recently with minimal additions to the place, you know, and how that's changed. So we talk about the little old mom and pop resorts. We talk about the Grandview hotels. We talk about the Rutgers Hotel. We talk about hotels all over the country that has led them to have lake experiences.
Norman! Come here, come here. Norman! The loons. They're welcoming us back.
How do you think?
Speaking of the Legacy of the Lakes Museum, and one of the things you've touched on also is how the times change. Things have changed, buildings have come and gone, boats have come and gone, and they start to make a bit of a comeback. That's something that you touch on at the Legacy of the Lakes Museum also, and not just in times of history, but in the fact that there's always something different. From one year to the next, one thing's being removed and being replaced by something else. How do you keep history young again?
Well, that's one of the things we take pride in, changing at least 30% of the exhibits every year. For example, this year you'll walk in and you'll see something we call the Dream Boat section, and that is homemade individual boats. It might be something somebody made in their garage, might be in the granary, it might be a kit boat, it might be a school shop project, but to them it was their dream and they made that dream happen, so we honor that. Also, we rotate exhibits. Last year, we did something with the University of Minnesota, Brandenburg, his 90-day shoot in the Boundary Waters. Beautiful stuff. This year, we're cooperating with the Smithsonian Institute. X-ray vision, it's called, the skeletal approach to fish from all over the world. It's kind of a science art exhibit. We have a Japanese form of painting fish, a local artist does, so we're changing things up. And we can go right to the museum and talk about how things change. We added to the fiberglass exhibits, expanded that, some things that are beautiful, some things that didn't quite work, you know, but they're all bright colors, shiny fiberglass, and very eccentric. So a helicopter boat that never will be near water and never is functional, but it was used to unveil a new Evan Ruth 4-cylinder engine. We go on to Minnesota Boat Builders. This year, honoring Larson Boat Works. So how they started building duck boats, went into wood boats, made the transition to fiberglass boats, and they're still a major part. Minnesota was a big deal in boating in the whole country because we had some major producers that are still in business that made it possible for average folks to take advantage of these lakes. I mean, we could, you didn't have to live on a lake. You could have this car, boat parked next to your house, have a trailer hitch, and you could take the whole family down the road and enjoy the lake treasures and the lake culture. As we travel on further, we're really blessed this year to have a cooperation with Lee and Penny Anderson. They have five of their beautiful boats down there, and what a dramatic change. He is a historical collector, and these are significant boats that are just jaw-dropping. Set in a very nice venue, it's a wonderful thing for our guests.
Let's take a bit of a shift here and take the eyes of a newcomer. there's some license plates out along the side of the road that are not from Minnesota. They're not from the Midwest. They are people that are not really familiar with the Lakes culture. And to know Bruce Olson is to know he is, what should we use for a term? He's a very outgoing, passionate guy, not just about boats, but about the Lakes culture.
You actually deliver the mail in a boat, huh? What an incredible tradition.
Oh, Charlie's a legend on this lake.
Bruce, where are we going to find you if I want to chit-chat today? Where are you going to be today?
I'm going to be down by Stella. We have two boats here, a beautiful 24-foot Garwood that used to be owned by the University of Wisconsin. It was their coach's rowing boat. And next to it is Stella with the Siri top. We're giving rides. Stop in. This guy's got a Legacy of the Gardens hat on and shades. I want to visit with you.
I'll tell you what, there's plenty of guys you want to sit down and talk with. This guy is one of them. Don't even let him get back to the dock. Just grab him on his way back to the dock. Because if you don't grab him, you're going to be hard luck to try to grab him then. Bruce, always a pleasure. Thank you for being.
Thank you.
Bruce, of course, from the Legacy of the Lakes Museum there in Alexandria, Minnesota. They'll be down at the end of the docks by Stella giving out boats, so make sure you don't miss out. Bruce, thank you very much.
I got started back when I was about 20 years old. I bought, for $200, I bought a U-22 that's sitting out in the docks right now. I did the whole thing myself. I redid the whole thing. Took about 3 years to get it done. And then I really fell in love with them. And, you know, we started a boat show. Actually, Greg Harrison is the one that started the boat show up on Cross Lake, but at Moonlight Bay. And I was a part of that. In fact, my boat that is out here today was the first boat ever registered for that show or any show in northern Minnesota.
And you've been around to a lot of different shows, not just Bar Harbor, not for just the Whitefish Chain. You've been down to Minnetonka. You've taken some of your boats out to places out in Washington State. You've been a part of the international show that we did here last year and others on top of it. From one show to the other, they all have their own flavor. They all have their own vibe. Some are a little more down key, some are a little more up key. What is it that keeps you coming back for 30 plus years now from one show after another?
You just aged me. I love these boat shows because they get to see these boats. You know, obviously what John Allen and Lee Anderson have done is just magnificent. And this place is really my favorite place to go to the boat show. The docks are just spectacular. The boats are spectacular. I don't have to tell you. Just walk around here and you'll see them. 30 years and 30 wonderful years of loving the boats. The thing that's so cool is people bring their boats, and some of them are great, some of them need a little work, but it doesn't make any difference. Being part of the whole episode and just being on those docks and looking at them all makes everyone feel great.
So we talked a moment ago about catching the bug. I mean, I caught my wood fever from you, and I know where you caught yours from. But this is where it starts. People that have come here for a couple of years as a spectator, people that are here for the very first time, this is where a place like this, you can catch the bug. Your grandfather had a Higgins, and that's kind of where it started for you. You bought one of your own. Tell me a little bit more about your journey into this mental illness we call wood fever.
You know, I remember up on Trout Lake, which is part of the Whitefish Chain, I remember that we had a wooden rowboat. My cousins and I would go out in that wooden boat and we would row and we'd row. And then all of a sudden you'd hear coming out of the channel from Whitefish to Trout Lake, somebody, some rich guy, had a big Chris Craft. And you'd watch that thing go across the lake and you'd think, someday I'm going to have one of those. And now I have four.
And you got one when you were about, you know, in college. What kind of a work did you have to put yourself through? I mean, today getting a wood boat is one thing. But back in whatever year, what did you have to do to really make that dream become a reality?
Well, as I said earlier, it was 3 years of work. We got the boat, it was sitting on a farm trailer. We hauled it into our place and I just started sanding, started working on it and put the first coat of varnish on it. I remember the first day I put that coat of varnish on it and I started running around in the yard thinking it looked so cool. And, you know, and then it was like 12 or 13 coats of varnish on a U-22, and it turned out to be a beautiful boat. It's down there, like I said, today, and it still is a beautiful boat.
So now you've got, that was the first of several, and you've got others now, and you've run the gamut from getting people to do the boat for you. A lot, that's one of the questions you hear a lot. How much work does it take? You're one of the skippers that actually knows, because not only do you'll get them done, but you've done the work yourself in garages with interesting stories I've heard I won't share in front of everybody. But I mean, do you feel like you miss out when you don't get to do it hands-on, or do you just get to enjoy it? What's been the change, the evolution of Wood Fever over the years for you?
Well, I think the first boat, which I did by myself, the difference is I have more money now, so I can afford to have somebody else do it for me. And, you know, I think of the four boats that I own, the one that's here is my first one. I have a boat, one of a kind, that was built in Bellingham, Washington, that I brought back here. We call it Rio Rita. The third one was just a triple, because I always wanted to have a triple. I thought they were so cool. And so I have one called Our Legacy. I actually bought it from the family of Christopher Columbus Smith, you know, Chris Pratt. Which I brought in here last year for the international show, is a 37-foot Elko that I bought out of the Sacramento River in Sacramento, California, shipped it to Seattle where I had it worked, and it took a year for them to fix that boat up and get it right, and it came in here, and last year it won the People's Choice at the international show.
Are one thing, the person is another thing. Since I live next door to you, I could share one story. One of your favorite pastimes, whether you're going to admit it or not, I know this to be true, is on your deck. You've got your chair, you've got your beverage, and you'll sit there and you'll look at your boats. Doesn't matter what you're doing, as long as you're sitting there taking it in and looking at the boats.
I find it easier to do that the older I get. I think that sitting and looking at those, what I really love is sitting there and watching other people come by in their boats and taking pictures of my boats sitting on their lifts, or when they're, particularly when I've got them uncovered and they've come by and they just one boat after another comes by, and it makes you believe that everyone loves these boats. I don't care whether you own one or not, but if you come out and look at them, you love them.
A day that I could give you, I'd give to you a day just like today.
If you want to get an appreciation for wood bolts, whether this is your first time at a boat show or you've come here every year, talking to the skippers, talking to the owners, these are the people that have the boats, these are the people that love the boats. There's plenty of skippers around you can talk to, and I can think of none better than Dave Thompson. Thanks for being a part of things.
Dave, I enjoyed doing this with you.
And thanks for giving me the fever. Dave Thompson, he's got his boat, the KT Jane, down on the docks at U-22. Make sure you go by and harass him and ask him questions about his love of wood boats in general, his love for that boat, the history of that boat. He'll talk your ear off, but you're going to leave in a richer experience, I promise you.
Rita, to have you here.
When the sun's at his back and the wind's in his face, it's just him and the wheel. He wouldn't take a million for the way it makes him feel. Boats, vessels of freedom, harbors of healing, boats. Vessels of freedom, harbors of healing, boats. Vessels of freedom, boats.
In smoke.
Now, there's plenty of boat shows in this here part of the world. Minnetonka is a great show. This is an amazing show, of course. The Whitefish Chain Boat Show, that's a big show, started in 1988. And that was started by the father of my guest right now, Mr. Greg Harrison, got that show started for the first year in 1988. His son briefly came in and took things over, moving out all the way from Seattle, Washington, spending his last full summer as a lake boy, but he will make a return appearance. But we thought we might as well have a chit chat real quick with Mr. Scott Harrison. Scotty, welcome to the boat show.
Glad to be here.
You didn't have a chance growing up, did you? You were going to get the wood fever or you were going to get kicked out of the house, knowing your dad, that you didn't have a chance, did you?
You know, that's one of the legacies he left me, was learning how to love all these wood boats and take care of them and restore them and make them beautiful again.
Now, here's the fun thing. Some people come to a show like this, and they see some of these boats, and they are amazing boats. some of these boats, they kind of hang out in a museum. They don't tend to go out unless it's a show. But you've taken it one step farther. Not only do you take your boat out, you have essentially started a mahogany motorcycle gang, except with wood boats. Tell me more about Team Wood.
Team Wood.
Oh, yeah.
Team Wood.
Team Wood is a group of close guys that are really into wood boats, and you have to have a certain panache or psyche to be brought into the crowd, and a little hazing is involved, but we brought in a new guy this year, and Mr. Charles Underbrink.
My name is Charlie.
And it's just a real good, close group of guys.
Hey, Linda, can you pass me one of those Coronas?
Hold on a minute. I gotta get the joint bonnet for the lobster.
Maybe we should crack open some of those macadamia nuts, too.
Oh, and can you pour me a Captain Morgan and Coke?
Okale Maluna.
This is not about carpooling. This is about, I got my boat, you got your boat, you got your boat. All right, let's go. We're going to get a parade. We're going to go down to this place. We're going to eat, drink, and be merry. This is the highlight, I would say, of the boating culture. And this is really your strength to the clan. What is it about these boats that gets your blood pumping, Scotty?
They're just, I just can't imagine building these things like the way they did without all the modern tools. And, you know, I'd love to go back into one of those factories and see how they, you know, bent the wood and carved a lot of it by hand and put on the varnish the way they did. And I think that would be really interesting. But they're just beautiful pieces of art. And, you know, we like to use them. You know, our boats don't sit. If I get a boat or rebuild a boat, I mean, it's a user boat. I mean, I want to use it, but take good care of it.
I know exactly what you mean. When I used to have a college job on the water on a weekday, if it wasn't too crowded, I took my wood boat to work. So it gets its nicks and its dings. Maybe they're not perfect, but they are absolutely beloved by the owner. So when it comes to these wood boats, this was something that was part of your culture getting into it. And you even for a while got roped into the Whitefish Chain Boat Show. Harrison is becoming one of those last names that's becoming synonymous, at least with the wood boat culture here in the North Country. What does that kind of a legacy mean to you? Does that give you pressure to live up to something, or do you absolutely take that mantle and run with it?
Well, I just really enjoyed watching my dad and working with him on some of the boats that that he did, and I saw his passion, and somehow I got the bug, and it, once you get it, you can't get rid of it, and you just can't have one. You know, once you have one, then you have to have another one, and before you know it, you have a whole fleet sitting in multiple storages and filled up your garage, and the cars are now sitting outside.
I'll let you know, I have one. I've just got one because that's all I can afford. So now, you make your home most of the year in the Seattle area, and that's a big mecca of wood boatdom. What kind of a difference is there in the boating culture here in northern Minnesota versus around Lake Caroline, for example? They got a big show out there. What's the culture difference like here versus there?
Everybody!
Here it's, you know, it's all freshwater. So the boats are a little smaller, a little more unique. There's not that many smaller, you know, under 22-foot runabouts and stuff out there because it's bigger water and it's more salt water. A lot of the boats you see back there are more yacht version. But, you know, because the way the weather is, they seem to last forever. And it's one of the few places in the country, Portland and Seattle are one of the two places in the country where you can buy a 45 or a 49 Chris Craft that's in, you know, really nice condition.
Is there a difference to if you had a place on the lakes or on the salt water out there that you could just jump down to the dock, hop on, grab your Team Wood, and off you go, versus here where you get a quick little runabout? Is the culture different?
I think once you're into these, you know, these wood boats and these antique wood boats, you have that mindset. So whether you have a 17-footer or a 67-footer, you know, they're all the same kind of people.
Scott is one of those guys, no disrespect when I say, not necessarily an expert on wood boats, but if you want to talk about wood boat and the boating culture, you're going to be hard-pressed to find somebody who knows better about what he's talking about. Scott Harrison has a pedigree and a legacy in wood boats, and if you want to get into an interesting chit-chat over a nice frosty beverage, Scott's going to be your man. And Scotty, I know you're going to be back. You're not going to be disappearing, but you are going to be pulling up some roots here in a way. This is your last summer at your place up on Whitefish. leaving this kind of boat culture behind. This is one of those more of a personal question, but how's this going to affect you going forward for the short term anyway?
Well, for the short term, you know, it's going to be difficult not being able to just walk down on your dock and take a boat out, just, you know, drop it off your lift and out you go, and that's what I'll really miss, other than having to trailer to a launch and do all that kind of stuff. I will miss that and stopping by people's place or going down to Manhattan Beach and, you know, having a drink with the gang at the tiki, or, you know, boating over to somebody's house for dinner, and or going out and watching the sunset in a nice wood boat. You know, those are all the things I'm really going to miss. It's just a temporary change for us right now, and we just have other things we'd like to do. You know, Harrisons have been here for 5 generations. I'm not going to let that slide. We're just going to take a little bit of a hiatus here.
We completely understand. We're going to totally miss you, but you know, when the summer of 2017 or any other time of year comes around, I'm sure a show of hands will pop up, anyone that will offer you the bees, a bed, a boat, and a beer, and my place included. Scotty, it's been a pleasure, and it's not done yet, and thank you for being a part of all of it to the levels that you have.
Thank you, David. It's really a pleasure.
Thank you much. Mr. Scott Harrison.
Goodbye to you, my trusted friend. I wish that we could both be there. We had joy.
Scotty, of course, part of the great boating culture here in northern Minnesota or Seattle or wherever he tends to go. So, Scotty, we thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you for bringing your boats. Drive safely, whether on land, by sea, or by air. And we hope to see you next year at the 2017 Gull Lake Boat Show at Bar Harbor.
Thank you.